Dreams by Sigmund Freud. This book is read by Jonathan Reese. This recording of the full-length reading of Dreams was produced in 1996 by Joss Recordings, which holds the copyright thereto. This recording nor any part thereof may be reproduced or used for any purpose without prior written authority from Joss Recordings. Sigmund Freud's basic work of dream interpretation was divided into a series of lectures that were given by him at the University of Vienna in 1915 and 1916. One must first learn two fundamentals. One, that psychic processes are inherently unconscious. Those which are conscious are isolated acts and part of the total psychic process. Two, instinctive impulses, particularly the sexual, in either the narrower or the broader sense of the term, play a major role in determining our psychic life. Errors are caused by the influence of unconscious psychic processes. For example, an engineer damaged some equipment which he knew full well how to use and which he was testing in preparation for a lecture the following day. He later admitted that he disliked the thought of giving the lecture, and the strength of this dislike had caused the confusion that led him to turn a valve in the wrong direction, although, as a conscientious man, he intended to deliver the lecture. Slips of the tongue such as, "Let us roast our esteemed colleague," instead of "Let us toast our esteemed colleague," are the result of failure to suppress the word one unconsciously wishes to say. The same is true of slips such as saying, "He is a grave man," when one had begun to say "good" and then in mid-word felt impelled to change the adjective to "brave." The dream. The dream is our psychic life during sleep. The biological intention of sleep is recuperation. Its psychological use is suspension of interest in the external world. Dreams are influenced by both external and internal situations. I dream I am riding in an outboard motorboat and awaken to the sound of the lawnmower's motor. Or I am hungry and dream of food. It is important to compare sleeping dreams with daydreams. In daydreams, we straightforwardly know we are creating a fantasy world that satisfies our wishes and ambitions. The reason for the content of a sleeping dream is not at all clear. Thinking hard about the meaning of a dream will produce no results. But a technique that will produce results is free association, simply allowing one's thoughts to follow where they will and saying whatever comes into one's mind. This is not a simple matter, for soon we find we are rejecting certain thoughts that occur to us, calling them too ridiculous, trivial, or inappropriate. Obviously, we resist the process of free association as it uncovers facts about our dreams. But, without exception, the thoughts we resist are the most important in dream interpretation. A man dreams his brother is in a closet. The first association is clothes press. He thinks this to be ridiculous, but immediately remembers that his brother is close-pressed for money. Evidently, the unconscious part of the mind, from which the associations as well as the dreams stem, has a logic of its own. Distortion is not inherent in a dream. We know this from investigating children's dreams. These dreams are straightforward fulfillments of wishes. A child away from home is homesick and dreams he is home. Adult dreams, too, are in a modified way wish fulfillments. From this fact, we can learn that dreams are not disturbers of sleep, but rather guardians of sleep. They present us with satisfactions of our desires in order to quell disturbances. Why, then, are most dreams not straightforward wish fulfillments as are little children's? Because as we grow older, we learn about right and wrong, and since much of our basic desires involve those things which are taboo or modified by moral precepts, especially sexual desires and desires to commit hostile and violent acts, we find that these things are not allowed to appear directly in our dreams. Instead, they are modified by regrouping, substitution, displacement, and other devices that disguise them. And the psychic mechanism that causes such changes is the dream censor. It is our inhibitions based on moral precepts that hold back the meanings of a dream as we try to probe it by means of free association. Also, if the dream censor did not operate to disguise our raw desires, Their fulfillment in a dream would not allow the dream to function as a sleep preserver, but would shock us into wakefulness. Since there is a direct connection between the original impulse and its form as modified in the dream by the dream censor, the modified material is symbolic in nature. For example, elongated objects, pencils, nails, guns, swords, etc., may be symbols for the male genital organ, while concave objects, caves, pits, boxes, closets, etc., may be symbols of the female genital organ. The process of distorting a dream is called dream work. One of the methods of distortion is condensation, by which ideas or pictures are run together, as in the slip of the tongue when good and brave were condensed to grave. Another process is displacement, by which the true psychic element is replaced by a seemingly unimportant element, so that the dream centers elsewhere. A third process is translation, by which ideas are translated into visual images. Upon interpreting dreams successfully, we find that the unconscious psychic life that is the site of our latent dreams is that of our infantile years, direct, violent, selfish. If dreams are wish fulfillments, why are some of them painful? One reason is that the dream work is incompletely done. However, it can be demonstrated that painful as the manifest dream may be, the latent material from which it was fashioned was even more painful. Another reason is that the dreamer's moral precepts get in the way and condemn as an unpleasant situation that which his more primitive instincts desired. In this latter case, if the dream's censorship fails and painful material gets into the manifest dream, the censor destroys sleep, but not before some of the tabooed material has entered the awakening sleeper's consciousness. In fabricating a dream, the latent dream thoughts residing in the unconscious make use of thoughts the sleeper had very recently, usually the day before, and called day remnants as vehicles for its material. Chapter 1. Difficulties and Preliminary Approach to the Subject. One day, the discovery was made that the symptoms of disease in certain nervous patients have meaning. It was upon this discovery that the psychoanalytic method of treatment was based. In this treatment, it happened that patients, in speaking of their symptoms, also mentioned their dreams, whereupon the suspicion arose that these dreams, too, had meaning. However, we will not pursue this historical path, but will strike out in the opposite direction. Our aim is to demonstrate the meaning of dreams in preparation for the study of the neuroses. There are good grounds for this reversal of procedure, since the study of dreams is not merely the best preparation for that of the neuroses, but a dream is itself a neurotic symptom, and, moreover, one which possesses for us the incalculable advantage of occurring in all healthy people. Indeed, if all human beings were healthy and would only dream, we could gather almost all the knowledge from their dreams which we have gained from studying the neuroses. So dreams become the object of psychoanalytic research, another of these ordinary, underrated occurrences, apparently of no practical value, like errors, and sharing with them the characteristic of occurring in healthy persons. But in other respects, the conditions of work are rather less favorable. Errors had only been neglected by science. People had not troubled their heads much about them, but at least it was no disgrace to occupy oneself with them. True, people said, there are things more important, but still something may possibly come of it. To occupy oneself with dreams, however, is not merely unpractical and superfluous, but positively scandalous. It carries with it the taint of the unscientific, and arouses the suspicion of personal leanings towards mysticism. The idea of a medical student troubling himself about dreams when there is so much in neuropathology and psychiatry itself that is more serious, tumors as large as apples compressing the organ of the mind, hemorrhages, chronic inflammatory conditions in which the alterations in the tissues can be demonstrated under the microscope. No, dreams are far too unworthy and trivial to be objects of scientific research. There is yet another factor involved which, in itself, sets at defiance all the requirements of exact investigation. In investigating dreams, even the object of research, the dream itself is indefinite. A delusion, for example, presents clear and definite outlines. "I am the Emperor of China," says your patient plainly. But a dream? For the most part, it cannot be related at all. When a man tells a dream, has he any guarantee that he has told it correctly, and not perhaps altered it in the telling, or been forced to invent part of it on account of the vagueness of his recollection? Most dreams cannot be remembered at all, and are forgotten except for some tiny fragments. And is a scientific psychology or a method of treatment for the sick to be founded upon material such as this? A certain element of exaggeration in a criticism may arouse our suspicions. The arguments brought against the dream as an object of scientific research are clearly extreme. As to the indistinctness of dreams, that is a characteristic like any other. We cannot dictate to things their characteristics. Besides, there are also dreams which are clear and well defined. Further, there are other objects of psychiatric investigation which suffer in the same way from the quality of indefiniteness. For example, the obsessive ideas of many cases, with which nevertheless many psychiatrists of repute and standing have occupied themselves. I will recall the last case of the kind which came before me in medical practice. The patient, a woman, presented her case in these words: "I have a certain feeling as if I had injured or had meant to injure some living creature, perhaps a child. No, a dog, rather, as if perhaps I had pushed it off a bridge or done something else." Any disadvantage resulting from the uncertain recollection of dreams may be remedied by deciding that exactly what the dreamer tells is to count as the dream, and by ignoring all that he may have forgotten or altered in the process of recollection. Finally, one cannot maintain in so sweeping a fashion that dreams are unimportant things. We know from our own experience that the mood in which we awake from a dream may last throughout the day, and cases have been observed by medical men in which mental disorder began with a dream, the delusion which had its source in this dream persisting. Further, it is told of historical persons that impulses to momentous deeds sprang from their dreams. We may therefore ask, what is the real cause of the disdain in which dreams are held in scientific circles? In my opinion, it is the reaction from the overestimation of them in earlier times. It is well known that it is no easy matter to reconstruct the past, but we may assume with certainty, you will forgive my jest, that as early as 3,000 years ago and more, our ancestors dreamt in the same way as we do. So far as we know, all ancient peoples attached great significance to dreams and regarded them as of practical value. They obtained from them auguries of the future and looked for portents in them. For the Greeks and other Orientals, it was at times as unthinkable to undertake a campaign without a dream interpreter as it would be today without air scouts for intelligence. When Alexander the Great set out on his campaign of conquest, the most famous interpreters of dreams were in his following. The city of Tyre, still at that time on an island, offered so stout a resistance to the king that he entertained the idea of abandoning the siege. Then one night he dreamed of a satyr dancing in triumph, and when he related this dream to his interpreters, they informed him that it foretold his victory over the city. He gave the order to attack and took Tyre by storm. Among the Etruscans and Romans, other methods of foretelling the future were employed, but during the whole of the Greco-Roman period, the interpretation of dreams was practiced and held in high esteem. Of the literature on this subject, the principal work, at any rate, has come down to us, namely, the book of Artemidorus of Daldis, who is said to have lived at the time of the Emperor Hadrian. How it happened that the art of dream interpretation declined later and dreams fell into disrepute, I cannot tell you. The progress of learning cannot have had very much to do with it, for in the darkness of the Middle Ages, things far more absurd than the ancient practice of the interpretation of dreams were faithfully retained. The fact remains that the interest in dreams gradually sank to the level of superstition and could hold its own only amongst the uneducated. In our day, there survive, as a final degradation of the art of dream interpretation, the attempts to find out from dreams numbers destined to draw prizes in games of chance. On the other hand, exact science of the present day has repeatedly concerned itself with the dream, but always with the sole object of illustrating physiological theories. By medical men, naturally, a dream was never regarded as a mental process, but as the mental expression of physical stimuli. Binse, in 1876, pronounced the dream to be a physical process, always useless and in many cases actually morbid, a process above which the conception of the world soul and of immortality stands as high as does the blue sky above the most low-lying, weed-grown stretch of sand. Maury compares dreams with the spasmodic jerkings of St. Vitus' dance, contrasted with the coordinated movements of the normal human being. In an old comparison, a parallel is drawn between the content of a dream and the sounds which would be produced if someone ignorant of music let his 10 fingers wander over the keys of an instrument. Interpretation means discovering a hidden meaning, but there can be no question of attempting this while such an attitude is maintained towards the dream performance. Look up the description of dreams given in the writings of Wundt, Jodl, and other recent philosophers. They are content with the bare enumeration of the divergencies of the dream life from waking thought with a view to depreciating the dreams. They emphasize the lack of connection in the associations, the suspended exercise of the critical faculty, the elimination of all knowledge, and other indications of diminished functioning. The single valuable contribution to our knowledge about dreams, for which we are indebted to exact science, relates to the influence upon the dream content of physical stimuli operating during sleep. We have the work of a Norwegian author who died recently, J. Murli Vold, 2 large volumes on experimental investigation of dreams, translated into German in 1910 and 1912, which are concerned almost entirely with the results obtained by change in the position of the limbs. These investigations have been held up to us as models of exact research in the subject of dreams. Now, can you imagine what would be the comment of exact science on learning that we intend to try to find out the meaning of dreams? The comment that has perhaps been made already. However, we will not allow ourselves to be appalled at the thought. If it was possible for errors to have an underlying meaning, it is possible that dreams have one too. And errors have, in very many cases, a meaning which has eluded the researches of exact science. Footnote. I refer to the errors that everyone commits, as when anyone wishes to say a certain thing but uses the wrong word, slip of the tongue, or when the same sort of mistake is made in writing, slip of the pen, in which case one may or may not notice it, or when anyone reads in print or writing something other than what is actually before him, misreading, or when anyone mishears what is said to him, naturally when there is no question of any disease of the auditory sense organ. Another series of such phenomena are those based on forgetting something temporarily, though not permanently. As, for instance, when anyone cannot think of a name which he knows quite well and is always able to recognize whenever he sees it, or when anyone forgets to carry out some intention, which he afterwards remembers and has therefore forgotten only for a certain time. This element of transitoriness is lacking in a third class, of which mislaying things so that they cannot be found is an example. This is a kind of forgetfulness which we regard differently from the usual kind. One is amazed or annoyed at it instead of finding it comprehensible. Allied to this are certain mistakes, in which the temporary element is again noticeable, as when one believes something for a time which both before and afterwards one knows to be untrue, and a number of similar manifestations which we know under various names. Close footnote. Let us adopt the assumption of the ancients and of simple folk and follow in the footsteps of the dream interpreters of old. First of all, we must take our bearings in this enterprise and make a survey of the field of dreams. What exactly is a dream? It is difficult to define it in a single phrase. Yet we need not seek after a definition when all we need is to refer to something familiar to everyone. Still, we ought to pick out the essential features in dreams. How are we to discover these features? The boundaries of the region we are entering comprise such vast differences, differences whichever way we turn. That which we can show to be common to all dreams is probably what is essential. Well, then, the first common characteristic of all dreams would be that we are asleep at the time. Obviously, the dream is the life of the mind during sleep, a life bearing certain resemblances to our waking life and at the same time differing from it widely. That, indeed, was Aristotle's definition. Perhaps dream and sleep stand in yet closer relationship to each other. We can be waked by a dream. We often have a dream when we wake spontaneously or when we are forcibly roused from sleep. Dreams seem thus to be an intermediate condition between sleeping and waking. Hence, our attention is directed to sleep itself. What, then, is sleep? That is a physiological or biological problem concerning which much is still in dispute. We can come to no decisive answer, but I think we may attempt to define one psychological characteristic of sleep. Sleep is a condition in which I refuse to have anything to do with the outer world and have withdrawn my interest from it. I go to sleep by retreating from the outside world and warding off the stimuli proceeding from it. Again, when I am tired by that world, I go to sleep. I say to it as I fall asleep, "Leave me in peace, for I want to sleep." The child says just the opposite. "I won't go to sleep yet. I'm not tired. I want more things to happen to me." Thus, the biological object of sleep seems to be recuperation, its psychological characteristic the suspension of interest in the outer world. Our relationship with the world which we entered so unwillingly seems to be endurable only with intermission. Hence we withdraw again periodically into the condition prior to our entrance into the world. That is to say, into intrauterine existence. At any rate, we try to bring about quite similar conditions, warmth, darkness, and absence of stimulus, characteristic of that state. Some of us still roll ourselves tightly up into a ball resembling the intrauterine position. It looks as if we grown-ups do not belong wholly to the world, but only by two-thirds. One-third of us has never yet been born at all. Every time we wake in the morning, it is as if we were newly born. We do, in fact, speak of the condition of waking from sleep in these very words. We feel as if we were newly born. And in this we are probably quite mistaken in our idea of the general sensations of the newborn infant. It may be assumed, on the contrary, that it feels extremely uncomfortable. Again, in speaking of birth, we speak of seeing the light of day. If this is the nature of sleep, then dreams do not come into its scheme at all, but seem rather to be an unwelcome supplement to it. And we do indeed believe that dreamless sleep is the best, the only proper sleep. There should be no mental activity during sleep. If any such activity bestirs itself, then in so far have we failed to reach the true prenatal condition of peace. We have not been able to avoid altogether some remnants of mental activity, and the act of dreaming would represent these remnants. In that event, it really does seem that dreams do not need to have meaning. With errors, it was different, for they were at least activities manifested in waking life. But if I sleep and have altogether suspended mental activity, with the exception of certain remnants which I have not been able to suppress, there is no necessity whatever that they should have any meaning. In fact, I cannot even make use of any such meaning, seeing that the rest of my mind is asleep. It can really then be a matter of spasmodic reactions only, of such mental phenomena only as have their origin in physical stimulation. Hence, dreams must be remnants of the mental activity of waking life disturbing sleep, and we might as well make up our minds forthwith to abandon a theme so unsuited to the purposes of psychoanalysis. Superfluous as dreams may be, however, they do exist nevertheless, and we can try to account for their existence to ourselves. Why does not mental life go off to sleep? Probably because there is something that will not leave the mind in peace. Stimuli are acting upon it, and to these it is bound to react. Dreams, therefore, are the mode of reaction of the mind to stimuli acting upon it during sleep. We note here a possibility of access to comprehension of dreams. We can now endeavor to find out, in various dreams, what are the stimuli seeking to disturb sleep, the reaction to which takes the form of dreams. By doing this, we should have worked out the first characteristic common to all dreams. Is there any other common characteristic? Yes, there is another, unmistakable and yet much harder to lay hold of and describe. The character of mental processes during sleep is quite different from that of waking processes. Dreams, we go through many experiences, which we fully believe in, whereas in reality we are perhaps only experiencing the single disturbing stimulus. For the most part, our experiences take the form of visual images. There may be feeling as well, thoughts too, mixed up with them, and the other senses may be drawn in. But for the most part, dreams consist of visual images. Part of the difficulty of reciting a dream comes from the fact that we have to translate these images into words. I could draw it, the dreamer often says to us, but I do not know how to put it into words. Now this is not exactly a diminution in the mental capacity as seen in a contrast between a feeble-minded person and a man of genius. The difference is rather a qualitative one, but it is difficult to say precisely wherein it lies. G. T. Fechner once suggested that the stage whereon the drama of the dream within the mind is played out is other than that of the life of waking ideas. That is a saying which we really do not understand, nor do we know what it is meant to convey to us, but it does actually reproduce the impression of strangeness which most dreams make upon us. Again, the comparison of the act of dreaming with the performances of an unskilled hand in music breaks down here, for the piano will certainly respond with the same notes, though not with melodies, to a chance touch on its keys. We will keep this second common characteristic of dreams carefully in view, even though we may not understand it. Are there any other qualities common to all dreams? I can think of none, but can see differences only, whichever way I look. Differences, too, in every respect, in apparent duration, definiteness, the part played by effects, persistence in the mind, and so forth. This is really not what we should naturally expect in the case of a compulsive attempt, at once meager and spasmodic, to ward off a stimulus. As regards the length of dreams, some are very short, containing only one image, or very few, or a single thought, possibly even a single word. Others are peculiarly rich in content, enact entire romances, and seem to last a very long time. There are dreams as distinct as actual experiences, so distinct that for some time after waking we do not realize that they were dreams at all. Others, which are ineffably faint, shadowy, and blurred. In one and the same dream, even, there may be some parts of extraordinary vividness alternating with others so indistinct as to be almost wholly elusive. Again, dreams may be quite consistent, or at any rate coherent, or even witty or fantastically beautiful. Others, again, are confused, apparently imbecile, absurd, or often absolutely mad. There are dreams which leave us quite cold, others in which every affect makes itself felt, pain to the point of tears, terror so intense as to wake us, amazement, delight, and so on. Most dreams are forgotten soon after waking, or they persist throughout the day, the recollection becoming fainter and more imperfect as the day goes on. Others remain so vivid, as, for example, the dreams of childhood, that 30 years later we remember them as clearly as though they were a part of a recent experience. Dreams, like people, may make their appearance once and never come back. Or the same person may dream the same thing repeatedly, either in the same form or with slight alterations. In short, these scraps of mental activity at nighttime have at command an immense repertory, can in fact create everything that by day the mind is capable of, only it is never the same. One might attempt to account for these diversities in dream by assuming that they correspond to different intermediate states between sleeping and waking, different levels of imperfect sleep. Very well, but then in proportion as the mind approached the waking state, there should be not merely an increase in the value, content, and distinctness of the dream performance, but also a growing perception that it is a dream. And it ought not to happen that side by side with a clear and sensible element in the dream, there is one which is nonsensical or indistinct, followed again by a good piece of work. It is certain that the mind could not vary its depth of sleep so rapidly as that. This explanation, therefore, does not help. There is, in fact, no shortcut to an answer. For the present, we will leave the meaning of the dream out of question and try instead, by starting from the common element in dreams, to clear a path to a better understanding of their nature. From the relationship of dreams to sleep, we have drawn the conclusion that dreams are the reaction to a stimulus disturbing sleep. As we have heard, this is also the single point at which exact experimental psychology can come to our aid. It affords proof of the fact that stimuli brought to bear during sleep make their appearance in dreams. Many investigations have been made on these lines, culminating in those of Moorley-Vold, whom I mentioned earlier. We have all, too, been in a position to confirm their results by occasional observations of our own. I will choose some of the earlier experiments to tell you. Maury had tests of this kind carried out upon himself. Whilst dreaming, he was made to smell some eau de cologne, whereupon he dreamt he was in Cairo, in the shop of Johann Maria Farina, and this was followed by some crazy adventures. Again, someone gave his neck a gentle pinch, and he dreamt of the application of a blister, and of a doctor who had treated him when he was a child. Again, they let a drop of water fall on his forehead, and he was immediately in Italy, perspiring freely and drinking the white wine of Orvieto. The striking feature about these dreams produced under experimental conditions will perhaps become still clearer to us in another series of stimulus dreams. These are three dreams of which we have an account by a clever observer, Hildebrandt, and all three are reactions to the sound of an alarm clock. I am going for a walk on a spring morning, and I saunter through fields just beginning to grow green, till I come to a neighboring village, where I see the inhabitants in holiday attire making their way in large numbers to the church, their hymn books in their hands. Of course, it is Sunday, and the morning service is just about to begin. I decide to take part in it, but first, as I am rather overheated, I think I will cool down in the churchyard which surrounds the church. Whilst reading some of the epitaphs there, I hear the bell ringer go up into the tower, where I now notice, high up, the little village bell which will give the signal for the beginning of the service. For some time yet it remains motionless, then it begins to swing, and suddenly the strokes ring out, clear and piercing, so clear and piercing that they put an end to my sleep. But the sound of the bell comes from the alarm clock. Here is another combination of images. It is a bright winter day, and the roads are deep in snow. I have promised to take part in a sleighing expedition, but I have to wait a long time before I am told that the sleigh is at the door. Now follow the preparations for getting in. The fur rug is spread out, and the foot muff fetched, and finally I am in my place. But there is still a delay while the horses wait for the signal to start. Then the reins are jerked, and the little bells, shaken violently, begin their familiar music, so loudly that in a moment the web of the dream is rent. Again, it is nothing but the shrill sound of the alarm clock. Now for the third example. I see a kitchen maid with dozens of piled-up plates going along the passage to the dining room. It seems to me that the pyramid of China in her arms is in danger of overbalancing. I call out a warning. Take care, your whole load will fall to the ground. Of course, I receive the usual answer, that they are accustomed to carrying china in that way, and so on. Meanwhile, I follow her as she goes, with anxious looks. I thought so. The next thing, as they stumble on the threshold, the crockery falls, crashing and clattering in 100 pieces on the ground. But I soon become aware that that interminably prolonged sound is no real crash, but a regular ringing. And this ringing is due merely to the alarm clock, as I realize at last on awakening. These dreams are very pretty, perfectly sensible, and by no means so incoherent as dreams usually are. We have no quarrel with them on those grounds. The thing common to them all is that in each case the situation arises from a noise which the dreamer on waking recognizes as that of the alarm clock. Hence we see here how a dream is produced, but we find out something more. In the dream there is no recognition of the clock, which does not even appear in it, but for the noise of the clock another noise is substituted. The stimulus which disturbs sleep is interpreted, but interpreted differently in each instance. Now why is this? There is no answer. It appears to be mere caprice. But to understand the dream, we should be able to account for its choice of just this noise and no other to interpret the stimulus given by the alarm clock. In analogous fashion, we must object to Maury's experiments that, although it is clear that the stimulus brought to bear on the sleeper does appear in the dream, yet his experiments don't explain why it appears exactly in that form, which is one that does not seem explicable by the nature of the stimulus disturbing sleep. And further, in Maury's experiments there was mostly a mass of other dream material attached to the direct result of the stimulus. For example, the crazy adventures in the Eau de Cologne dream, for which we are at a loss to account. Now will you reflect that the class of dreams which wake one up affords the best opportunity for establishing the influence of external disturbing stimuli. In most other cases, it will be more difficult. We do not wake up out of all dreams, and if in the morning we remember a dream of the night before, how are we to assign it to a disturbing stimulus operating perhaps during the night? I once succeeded in subsequently establishing the occurrence of a sound stimulus of this sort, but only, of course, because of peculiar circumstances. I woke up one morning at a place in the Tyrolese Mountains knowing that I had dreamt that the Pope was dead. I could not explain the dream to myself, but later my wife asked me, "Did you hear quite early this morning the dreadful noise of bells breaking out in all the churches and chapels?" "No, I had heard nothing. My sleep is too sound. But thanks to her telling me this, I understood my dream." How often may...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.